nice to be able to address you as Mr. Chairman. I get used to it.
It's nice.
Don't get too used to it. Mr. Chairman, first is House Bill 3, if the committee would indulge me and look at that legislation first. Mr. Chairman, House Bill 3 deals with dual enrollment, and simply put, what we're trying to accomplish here is to set in place a quality standard for our dual enrollment classes. As you all know, most dual enrollment courses across Virginia, many high school students take advantage of those, but some dual enrollment classes are of a higher standard of quality than others. And the goal of this legislation is first and foremost to set in place a quality standard that CHEV would work with our institutions of higher learning, and obviously the community college system, on establishing. And then to make sure that the credits apply equally no matter what that dual enrollment class is. So if a student is taking a dual enrollment class for history, as an example, that dual enrollment class would apply from the credit standpoint, would be either one or two or three credits, and that the students would be assured that no matter what institution of higher learning they may utilize that for, whether it's two-year institution or four-year institution, that course credit would apply equitably and equally. So that's basically what the legislation does. Mr. Chairman, I know you have a number of dual enrollment classes. I know Delegate Freitas, or enrollment bills, Delegate Freitas has one as well as others. I think at this point, my understanding from the letters that I've received from the speaker, if you act on these positively, they need to be reported and referred to the Appropriations Committee, where there is another comprehensive bill that's being looked at, both from the policy and the financial standpoint. So that is what House Bill 3 does.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Any questions from anyone on the committee? Is there anyone in the audience who'd like to speak in favor of this bill?
Morning, Mr. Chairman, members of the committee. It's Tom Smith, the Superintendent Association. We're in strong support of this bill. This is one of our top legislative issues and concerns, and we appreciate the Payton acting in this way to sort of get everything together so that we can have a clear picture of where we're headed with dual enrollment. It's an extremely important part of what we do in our public schools.
Thank you. Thank you.
Good morning, Mr. Chairman. I'm Ellen Davenport with the Virginia Community College System. We support the bill. You may recall that last September, JLARC released a report on the operations and performance of the community college system, and there were 21 recommendations, and 9 of those dealt with dual enrollment, and we appreciate Delegate Landis taking the lead and bringing forth this legislation.
Okay, thank you.
Good morning, Mr. Chairman, members of the committee. Beverly Covington with CHEV. We support the legislation. We've had a work group in place already working with the institutions and UCCS on various aspects of dual enrollment, and adding this quality piece is certainly going to enhance that. Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Good morning, Mr. Chairman. Kim McKay, Director of Public Policy for the Virginia Chamber of Commerce, and we support this legislation.
Good morning, Mr. Chairman, members of the committee. Jeremy Bennett, the Virginia School Boards Association. I'd like to echo the comments of Tom Smith, the BAS, and the BSB would support this piece of legislation.
Thank you.
Good morning, Mr. Chairman. Kathy Berkshire with the Virginia Education Association. And for all the reasons mentioned, we support this bill.
Thank you.
Good morning, Mr. Chairman. Get here with middle and high school principals. We associate our office with Dr. Smith. This is very important for our students, and we appreciate Rachel bringing the bill. Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, members of the subcommittee, I'm Mindy Carlin. I represent the Northern Virginia Chamber of Partnership, 6 chambers of commerce in Northern Virginia. We support this bill.
Thank you.
Good morning, Terry Weinstein, Fairfax Hampton, and Norfolk Federation of Teachers. We support the bill.
Good morning, Vernon Peters with the Virginia Profession of Educators, and we also support this bill.
Mr. Chairman, Frank Bradford of the Secretary's Office. The administration has not taken a position on the specific bills, but is encouraging additional pathways as long as quality is assured.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, I remind of a comment that one of my colleagues used to make, and that is Does anyone want to speak against this great bill? Those remarks spurring questions from anyone else?
Mr. Chairman?
Yes, sir.
I'd like to make a motion that we order to refer House Bill 3 for appropriation.
All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
I'm sorry, we have to word this down. So anyone wanting to wish to report and refer this great bill to the House Appropriations Committee, we signify by hitting yay and electronic voting device.
Next one I have is House Bill 344. Mr. Chairman, there is a substitute.
Okay.
Mr. Chairman, while the substitute is being passed out, I can describe the legislation and talk a little bit about the differences in the substitute and the original bill. I also say that Delegate Barak spoke to me about House Bill 1274. I think with the amendments that we're making, we're addressing part of the issue that he was concerned. And I'll go over that with the substitute. But Mr. Chairman, simply put, what this legislation is doing is to try to provide transparency related to our institutions of higher learning, their policies related to free speech. As those of you that have been on the subcommittee or the committee know, and we've dealt with this legislation, several years ago I carried legislation to make sure that there was a policy for institutions of higher learning so that both staff, faculty, and individuals that are invited to come onto campuses had certain understandings of what their rights were, and that there were policies, more importantly, that each institution would have related to free speech. And you'll notice that that's in Section A of the substitute was in Section A of the original bill. The intent here is, when you look under subsection B, is to make sure that not only are those policies in place, obviously we've passed that legislation in the past, but to make sure that actually the policies are understandable and, more importantly, that are accessible for students, faculty, staff, and the public. We really didn't require that before. So what we've done here with this legislation is to make sure that students' handbooks include the information, that the school website includes information, and that orientation programs that students have would have there, that information. We also, at the request of some of the institutions of higher learning with the substitute, Section C, rather than having training, which involves a lot more than what we were attempting to try to do, that also raises some issues related to cost and how that be implemented. That's much more robust than what we were attempting to do. We rewrote that Section C so that, and thanks to Ryan, that information would be developed in the policies established under Section B, to notify employees about their responsibilities related to free speech policies. Mr. Chairman, the other change from the original bill is, if you look at lines 32 through 34, Delegate LaRock's bill had some very prescriptive information on reporting to the General Assembly and the governor if there were situations or cases on campuses where someone's free speech rights may have been violated or the institution was sued. So what we tried to do, again, for transparency is include that language on 32 through 34, the substitute, which was not in the original bill. Again, Mr. Chairman, the intent of the legislation is just to provide more transparency. It's a follow-up on what we've already done. The policies that the General Assembly and the governor had signed into law in the past. I think the institutions of higher learning are more comfortable with this version based on my discussions with them over the weekend and as early as this morning as 6:30. That is, in fact, what the legislation does. I'd be glad to try to answer any questions, but the substitute, I believe, is in good form for your consideration.
Okay, let's get that in front of us. Anybody would like to make a motion? No, substitute. All right, all those in favor of adopting the substitute, say aye.
Aye.
Those aye. So substitute before us. Does anybody have any questions for Chairman Landis?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you for presenting this bill. I was on this committee last year and a couple of years before as well when this issue's come up before. And I think last year when the policy side became law, I was a little bit hesitant in the beginning during the subcommittee discussions to support it because anytime you try to codify the First Amendment, it's hard because the First Amendment is so broad and there's so many different years and years, decades of litigation that's been around free speech. And so to the extent that we have a robust body of law that's already out there for us to glean from, I think the First Amendment pretty much speaks for itself, plus its Supreme Court cases. But given the concerns of the chairman and others who have expressed their desire to make sure that Virginia public schools have something a little bit more concrete in place, I was convinced that having a policy statement was the right way to go. And so I did support the bill on the floor and as it came through the Senate as well. And so that, just for the, especially for the new folks on the committee, if you look at lines 12 through 14 on the substitute, that is already the existing code language that we adopted last year. And if you look at line 35, this bill would repeal the original language, so we don't have to put the language in the code. So that part is fine. The rest of the bill, I just want to ask the chairman if he could explain a little bit further. I do understand what you're trying to accomplish in giving them a little bit more of a prescriptive role as to what the schools have to do when there are instances like this that come up. My first question, Mr. Chairman, is are there other states that follow this process where other states have gone above and beyond having policy that they actually have a reporting mechanism as well?
Mr. Chairman, I would say to Delegate Keene that if you look at Delegate LaRocque's bill, there are legislatures that have adopted or have something similar to that legislation. What we were attempting to do is craft a Virginia avenue, if you will, and statute. And as Delegate Keene mentioned, I was trying to build on the work we had done before. And Delegate LaRocque and I had that discussion as well. So the intent here is just to provide some more transparency so that students and faculty and staff really know what the policies are. We've done all that work before, and as you mentioned, that is our work product from lines 12 through 14 from the past sessions.
Just a quick follow-up, Mr. Chairman.
Delegate King.
Sure. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, the other chairman, the Uber chairman. On lines 2 and beyond, especially on lines 32 and 34, this is some of the new language that I understand you're trying to accommodate some of the concerns that Delegate LaRocque has. Seems to me that 30 days after the institution is sued seems like a fairly short window, given that, especially the subcontractor knows as a litigator himself, that a lot of times when lawsuits are filed, within the first 30 days a lot can happen. It could be a nuisance lawsuit, it could be a suit that's a countersuit, it could create a lot more litigation in the court system, and frankly, within 30 days, you don't know whether those cases can go forward or not. It could be dismissed on the 31st day, it could also be settled within the a week or so after that. So I wonder if, just from a practical, logistical perspective, 30 days is a little too short of a time for the schools to figure out that this case is, in fact, legitimate, credible, is going forward, and that we need to report this to the state, as opposed to maybe waiting until a certain time where the complaint and the final complaint process has been closed, and the window is closed, so that now it's properly before the courts. And having said that, though, that's also the other question I have on this is too, is are we talking about any and all suits, because it could be federal, state, and local, or are we talking specifically state court suits, or the first one is usually a federal case, it may end up in federal courts. Are we talking about all potential suits and within 30 days? That seems a little onerous for me from a logistical perspective.
Mr. Chairman, I say you have to ask the institutions of higher learning. My discussions with them, I think they're comfortable with this. I mean, subcommittees can consider, another time frame if you want. I would say we're talking about all suits. I mean, obviously, you can sue in state court, you can sue in federal court. Again, the attempt is for transparency, which I think is a good thing. I don't think hiding anything is always the best policy from the state's perspective. I think actually this actually helps the institutions because it allows them to report to the General Assembly and make sure that they have basically said what actually is occurring. Sometimes these suits are frivolous. So it allows the institutions to protect themselves, I think, as well by providing that information to the General Assembly and the governor. One of the things that came up this morning is that, with the Attorney General's office, let us know, who knows? By putting it in the code, then we will know.
Thank you, Attorney. Have you said any better? Thank you, Mr. Chair. I'd be happy to listen to the witnesses.
Any questions? Any other questions from the committee? Is anyone in the audience who would like to speak in favor of the bill?
Good morning, Mr. Chairman. Members of the subcommittee, I'm Steve Rossi with the Family Foundation of Virginia.
Anyone in the audience would like to speak in opposition to the bill? Going once. Gone. Committee operates by motion. Have a motion. Motion to report and a second. Anyone you'd like to vote?
I didn't have a fiscal impact statement on this.
This would be just a motion to report to the full committee. The motion should include Delegate Hansen, your Chairman Hansen. Is your motion to support the substitute? I'm assuming that's what you're in front of us. All right, we have a proper motion. All those in favor of voting, all those who wish to vote in favor of this bill, please vote indicated by voting yay on it. We'll try to vote.
My understanding is none of these bills will be considered until Wednesday meeting of the committee. And yeah, I don't think our staff can turn around that quickly since we meet at 8:30.
You have one more bill.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I appreciate the committee's subcommittee's indulgence. Mr. Chairman, the next bill, the last bill, is House Bill 347. Mr. Chairman, as you all know, our young people enroll in an institution of higher learning. Again, this is another transparency-related bill. I've had more and more parents come to me and say, I want to know what the information is related to the major and what the employment opportunity might be for my student or my child after they graduate. And all we're attempting to do here is this information is already being collected. Most institutions of higher learning, I think all of them, are collecting information for what their graduates and their alumni are actually getting from the standpoint of their degrees. So what we're trying to do here from a transparency standpoint is to make sure that the information is actually published by the institutions of higher learning. And I'm trying to see if there's, it's a pretty simple concept. Right now, that information, as I mentioned, is collected, but there's not an assurance that that information actually be shared with the young people enrolling in the institutions of higher learning. Again, another avenue to just try to provide more transparency. parents in, again, trying to get information and data out so that students and parents can see what the opportunities are related to the majors or the majors that they may want to enroll in from the standpoint of job opportunities and salaries later on upon their graduation. So, Mr. Chairman, that's what this legislation is working towards.
Okay. Thank you. Any questions from the committee for the majors? Anyone in the audience like to speak in favor of this bill?
Good morning, Mr. Chairman, members of the committee. Beverly Covington with Chef. We do support the bill. Our major reports are already formatted in this way, as aggregated. We think there will just be some minor adjustments as far as how the information is shared with students.
Okay, thank you. Anyone else? Anyone like to speak in opposition to the bill? Motion would be in order.
Second.
Here we have a motion of support, proper second. All those wishing to vote in favor of the ordinance bill is the full committee. Please indicate by voting yes on these or electronic voting board. The report's with a vote of 8-0. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman.
Okay. Yes, we had two other chairmen here, and I believe Chairman Bell signed first. Chairman Bell here.
Here I'm just yelling at Bell. I literally thought you were talking about the other R. Bell, Mr. Chairman.
Okay.
Are you calling me up, Mr. Chairman?
If you're ready.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Chairman, this is a measure that you've seen before, passed out last year. It was 15-7 in the full committee. And the issue is we have just over 40,000 homeschool kids in the Commonwealth. And if you're new to the subcommittee, I count at least these two. And if you've never been to see homeschoolers and have impressions from 20 years ago, I encourage you to go visit because it's no longer a small, tiny group of people going for a very specific reason. It's an everyday choice. Parents make for lots of reasons. The kids go back and forth. The law is permeable. And for all those reasons, we have kids who are homeschooling who are high school age. Now, it's a fairly modest number. I have the figures here that in the entire Commonwealth, pursuant to the statute, the kids who are homeschooling is 8,600. So it's not a huge number. And in about half of the jurisdictions, those students are allowed to go into the local high school and participate with classes. And this addresses a small part of that small part, which would be, as you've just been hearing, there are, of course, dual enrollment classes at the high school level. Many students, it's the only game in town. And if you're living in a county without a community college, the only place to get college-level classes is those dual enrollment classes offered through the high school, at the high school. And this would say that if a high school offers those college classes approved by the Commonwealth, they have to allow the local homeschoolers who would otherwise be eligible to come in as students, that to live in the area, be right age, and those things, to enroll in the dual enrollment classes as part-time students. The subcommittee or committee, I forget which, made an amendment, which is reflected in the bill that you have before you, and that's the bill that I'm chair, and I respectfully ask you to give it the same consideration, but the result that you gave last year, which would be to pass it on. The final result was it passed the body, went to the other body, and was not successful there. It got in committee in the Senate.
Thank you, Delegate Bell. We do have a speaker's letter on this, so at the proper time, when we act on it, we'll send appropriations if the committee decides to act on it favorably. Are there any questions for the patron?
Last year, raising concerns in the same conversation we had about this bill, mainly based on the fiscal impact and the fact that those community colleges would have to bear much of that burden. I'm just wondering if anything has changed in last year's. I didn't get a chance to read the bills comparatively with last year's. I'm wondering if anything has changed since last year's version and this year's version as it relates to the fiscal impact concerns raised by the community colleges.
No, sir. If they are enrolled as part-time students, which addresses the local concern, there would be some impact for the state, which is what the chairman said it needs to go upstairs. I'll note that obviously the net-net, the homeschoolers are saving everybody a lot of money. And these are students who, by definition, live in the right community, could walk in the door, say, I'm here, and take full advantage of all of the costs associated with their education at the local level. They're saying, we'll still manage, what percentage would be, 84% of it, but we're asking you to help us with the 16%.
appropriations last year, so to the extent it goes to appropriations, I'd be fine with that, but I would, if I were to make a motion, I'd make a motion just to refer without appointing, but I'll defer to my colleagues on my majority side.
All right, any other questions from the committee? Is there anyone in the audience who'd like to speak in favor of this bill?
Good morning again, Mr. Chairman, members of the committee. I'm Steve Rossi, Family Foundation of Virginia, and we glad to support the bill.
Anyone else want to speak in favor of the bill? Those opposed?
Mr. Chairman, Ellen Davenport with the Virginia Community College System. Because of the fiscal impact, we can't support the bill. We estimate that it's going to be at least $2 million cost. We would have to absorb, and we would probably do that by increasing tuition to our other students. So we've had conversations with Doug at Bell about the bill in the past. So this is the same position we had previously. It needs to go to appropriations.
Okay, thank you.
Mr. Chairman, Stacey Haney of the African Virginia School Boards Association. We're also opposed to the bill. The current policy of the Commonwealth is to allow each local school board to decide whether to allow part-time enrollment of any student or to require full-time enrollment in order to participate in the activities of the local school division. As Delegate Bell mentioned, about half of the school divisions in the state do allow for part-time enrollment, which would allow homeschool students to participate in dual enrollment and other part-time enrollment. But it's our position that that's a decision that is best made at the local level by the local school board to determine what's best for its community. So therefore, we oppose the bill.
Chairman, members of the committee, Tom Smith, Superintendent's Association. We oppose the bill for the same reason stated by the School Boards Association.
Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, Kathy Burchard of the Virginia Education Association. Because of the potential fiscal impact, the DEA opposes this bill.
Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, that New York Middle and High School Principals. We did have some questions about the enrollment and the fact that we do believe that it should be maintained as a school board association position to let the local school board do this. We also had a question, Mr. Chairman, about the Virginia placement test and who would be responsible for administering those. I just got the question last night, Delegate Bell, so thank you.
Barry Weinstein, Federation of Teachers. We believe this is a local control issue best handled by our school board. Thank you very much.
Okay. Delegate Bell, would you like to respond to any of those remarks?
Very good. So, you know, we keep advocating for the home school is to bring back more and more modest bills. And it could have been a bill that if a student lives in the area, now that half of the school district is there, can take you. And it's working, we could have said, you gotta take them. We can do that. We said, if you're gonna offer what our community college classes, because that's what dual enrollment is, it's not an AP class, it's not a high school teacher, it's often the same person that moment working as a community college professor. If you're gonna have a community college professor offer classes in a publicly funded building that is called the high school, for convenience of all the high school students, which is great, and you have someone who's the right age to walk into that school, but his parents say, this year, Mark needs the special attention as a homeschooler. We're gonna say you should have to offer those college, community college classes to Mark. That's all it says. And the collective reaction, which is drop dead, or come in and be a public school student, the two options being offered last year, the community colleges said they were working on this. We waited diligently to see what they would come in with, and here we are. It's January 22nd, to my knowledge, it hasn't moved one inch. So all we're asking would be to say, this is a student, he is a child, he lives in the community, his parents are paying taxes. Again, he could walk in that first day or even the fourth day and say, I live here, I want to take that class, the school would have to take it. Somehow all of these financial issues would just disappear. But instead, because he dares to homeschool, we have the line of people we have every time they're homeschooling. Respectfully ask you to report the bill. Now, this year's department that goes there would ask you to report for that's our request. Thank you, sir.
Okay. Any other questions about
I'd say to the gentlelady, if you are fully homeschooled and just stay at home, then that's right, the head, the per head, if you will, does not come in with you to the public school. And that's why this bill would say you are enrolled as a matric and terminology guide. As a part-time student, at which point some of it does.
So at that point in time, some of the state dollars would go into the school.
Yes, sir.
So they're not coming in at $0.
That's my understanding. Again, this is not an area of the law in which I consider myself an expert, but that's how staff explained when it was drafted last year.
So I guess second question.
Delegate Robinson.
Sit as high at the desk and listen to the same thing the teachers are thinking will cost all that money. I don't understand. I'm sure there's some testing costs that come with it. I'm sure that there's like sort of the copy. It's a little complicated how the teacher is paid because it is often the same high school teacher that's teaching geometry in the second block, third block becomes a college professor. The money sort of cycles through the community college and comes back. And I understand it's how harmless money's given. There's nobody's given a dog, but that's how the money cycles through. But my understanding is that many colleges believe that they will lose whatever the figure they just cited.
Are they paying on a per student basis?
Are the professors? I don't know the
in answer. That dual enrollment class?
I don't know the answer to that. I'm sorry.
Okay. Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, I have a question. Delegate Bell. I move that the subcommittee recommend reporting and referring the bill. Then we have a proper motion to report referred appropriations with a second. All those who wish to support that motion, vote yay on the electronic voting machine. Bill reports. You missed it, I think. Bill fails to report.
Thanks, okay.
Delegate Cole.
Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I have two bills before you before we get started. One, I'd like to just ask you to take up House Bill 1322 first. This would, similar to Delegate Bell's bill, but actually broader, that we're, would allow anybody to enroll at a dual enrollment community college course. There were issues raised about security, and I would ask that the subcommittee play House Bill 1322 on the table. So.
Second.
Okay, there's been a motion to lay House Bill 1322 on the table. There's been a second. Any discussion on that motion?
It's not
debatable. All right, all those in favor of the motion, please vote yay on the electronic voting machine. Motion carries 8-0.
All right, thank you. The next bill is House Bill 1321. What this bill does is I've received, years ago we passed legislation to require our four-year institutions to enter into matriculation agreements with our community colleges. Prior to that, some of our four-year institutions kind of looked down their nose at community college credits. Wouldn't necessarily accept them. What I've heard is that while technically they are complying with the law and accepting community college credits, they are not necessarily accepting them in the major. So say somebody's in Northern Virginia and they get an associate's degree, in biology from Northern Virginia Community College, and they field of the major. They'll accept them as general education, make the students retake the courses in the major. So this would tell the schools that they have to accept it within the major, you know, as credits on their major field. And also, the second part of this is that I've also heard that some of our four-year institutions are not treating dual enrollment credits that are offered through our high schools, that they're not accepting them at the same level that they are the regular community college courses. And this would say that you had to give the same credit for dual enrollment classes that you give for regular community college classes. And that's basically the bill.
Any questions from the committee?
Chairman?
Delegate Robbins.
So we just dealt with Delegate Landis's bill. Are these like one step one, step two?
I did not put in this legislation in coordination with Chairman Landis. I put this in based on feedback I've gotten from some of my community colleges. And I think this is just clarifying current policy. When we passed those matriculation requirements several years ago, that this was, I think, the intent, legislative intent that we had. And some of our four-year institutions are kind of trying to do an end around on that.
Any other questions
from
the committee? Is anyone here to speak in favor of the bill?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Ellen Davenport with the Virginia Community College System. We do support the bill. And I just would like to clarify kind of how we got to this point. In 2012, legislation passed that required every school division to have an agreement with the community college in the service region to offer dual enrollment classes that would lead to a uniform certificate of general studies. Prior to that, dual enrollment was mostly offered in economically distressed parts of the state and rural areas. And so after 2012, there was a lot more dual enrollment offered, which is kind of how we ended up where we are now with varying agreements, varying pricing, and so forth. We've been working with the four-year institutions and the State Council of Higher Education of Virginia to align all of this, but and we really appreciate what Delegate Cole is doing and the others who brought more legislation this year.
Thank you.
Chairman, Committee, Tom Smith, Superintendent Association. These dual enrollment programs are becoming a bigger and bigger part of what we do at the high school level. We appreciate the Delegate bringing something like this. Delegate Landis's bill, a lot of the confusion that's out there and disappointment once the child signs up for a course, passes it, expects it to be credited, and then finds out in May after they've been accepted or haven't been accepted that it's not going to work. So this is a big step forward. Thank you.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, Vernon Peters with Virginia Professional Educators, and we support the bill.
Is there anyone who wishes to speak in opposition to the bill? Mr.
I didn't hear this from any of the four years, but I support the idea, but I just wanted to double check because I'm familiar with Northern Virginia, and Delegate Cole did mention Northern Virginia Community Colleges. And I know the great work that George Mason and Northern Virginia Community Colleges have been doing to partner and to provide this type of consistency and make sure that the young students from high school on are up. Would anything in this legislation affect the 4 years that the policies that they're adopting now, to the extent that this becomes either a minimum or a ceiling? In other words, does this create a floor or a ceiling to comply, or is this just consistency where the council would have to just coordinate with all the 4 years and make sure that everybody's working on the same sheet of music? I just don't want to stop the schools from doing something more that they're already doing by inadvertently putting this language that creates either a floor or a or a ceiling on what they're trying to accomplish. Is that something that any of the 4 years, if there's no concern, I'm fine with it, but I just want to make sure we're thinking this through, because to the extent that we're asking the chef to come up with some guidelines, we don't want the guidelines to be either the minimum or the maximum from what the schools are already doing.
None of the four-year institutions have contacted me with concerns about this legislation. I think if they had some, that they're usually not shy about. So again, in my opinion, this legislation is just clarifying what our original intent was, at least my intent was when we passed the matriculation agreements several years ago.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm fine with that.
Mayor, okay. Motion.
I think we're good, Mr. Chairman.
We have a motion to report and a second. All those in favor of on that motion, please indicate by recording the electronic voting machine. Okay, bill report 7-4.
Thank you. Bill.
Okay, Delegate Freitas.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I think this should actually probably be fairly quick. On HB, I'm assuming HB 535 is up first, whichever is desired. Great. So on HB 35, this one is very similar to Chairman Landis's bill. And as much as I love my bill, I think I'm going to trade it in for a co-patron sheet. So if I could request this bill be tabled, I would appreciate it.
I'm sorry, what was the motion? Table. Okay. Is there a second? Is there a second? Okay. All right. All those in favor of laying this. Gently laying this bill on the table, please indicate by voting yes on the electronic vote. Can I get a win?
Of sorts, Mr. Chairman. This is the most support I've gotten from Delegate King on the bill.
Mr. Yellen, stop me at a picture.
Yeah. Mr. Chairman, on HB 542, this is another bill that deals with dual enrollment. I'm just going to give a quick explanation and the request of why. The reason for it is what we're trying to do is set up an environment where right now students are limited to what community college they can take dual enrollment classes through based off of their geography. This poses some problems. I'll give you an example. In Culpeper County, if you live on one side of the county, you might be a lot closer to Germana. If you live on another side of the county, you might be a lot closer to Lord Fairfax. What we're trying to do within the language of bill is ensure that a student would not be limited to what dual enrollment class that they could enroll in. But I think there may be some problems with respect to some additional burdens this could put on the high schools that we're not looking to do. I thought we might be able to fix it with a quick alignment amendment, but I think it's going to take a little bit of a special type of request of this board to apply.
Temporarily?
Yes.
Okay, sure.
Or actually, well, by for the week would be the appropriate for the week.
Yes, all right. So. Happy to do that, but you get it in the line, and there are a lot of bills in our office.
I understand.
All right. So we've got a motion to pass by the bill temporarily for the week, and maybe it might have time to be heard later on. Is there a second?
Sure.
Okay. This is a voice vote. Okay, so all those in favor of passing the bill by temporarily, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Vote the same sign. Second, Mr. Chairman. And for the record, Delegate King voted for that one, too.
A roll.
I think this concludes the docket, except for a little bit of housekeeping matters, and that is to dispose of Delegate Barak's bill, and I think in keeping with what we're trying to do to keep matters clean and simple this year with all the legislation.